Hello, this is Andy Schaefer's NXCAM application engineer at Maya with a presentation today on contact curves in NXCAM. Contact curves have existed in NX for a number of years now. However, it's just with the 1899 release that we have the ability to display them on the screen. So I have a two-part presentation today. First, I'm going to show you how you could use those in NX1899 to improve your productivity with multi-axis programming. Then in the second part of the video, I've created a Python macro, which we're going to give away, which allows users of 1102 or NX12 or NX1847 to essentially have that same capability by creating those contact curves as lines on the face of their machining. So before we begin though, there's something you need to do with your operations before the contact curve display will work. We're going to double click on the operation, and in the path settings, non-cutting moves, you'll go to the more and look at your output contact data. You need to check that box, regenerate, and then click OK. I've already got that created, so I'm just going to hit cancel. Then, to see the contact curves, we come to the display area here on your home tab. Look at the more tab here on the right side, and under points display, look for contact points. And there they are. To understand what the contact is doing, I really need to show you the tool. So I'm going to select the tool display here, and then I think it's clear what's going on. I am using an optimized to drive technique. I've picked up the heel of the tool, so it's machining complete up to about this level, which is then indicated by the contact curves. I've had to stop here because otherwise my tool is going to run into this overhang. The objective then is I need a third operation. It's going to be this variable axis guiding curves, and I would like to have this curve, which is the upper end of this operation. It'll be the lower end of the variable axis guiding curve command. But where do I need to draw that curve? Well, I think you can see that having those contact curves is going to make it easier to see those. Now, let's continue. I'm going to show you now in two steps how to create a spline. There's probably any number of ways to do this. I'm just showing you one technique that works. The trick here is that I'll be drawing the spline kind of in air, and then I need to project it down. The only thing that's really critical is that the view I'm in when I'm drawing needs to have the same normal vector as the vector I use when I do the projection. So here I'm going to select the z-axis, choose face normal just to kind of get this z-axis tipped about normal to where I'm working. Again, doesn't have to be perfect. Okay, let's hit escape and work with that. Next, I need to move my view so that it aligns with that z-axis. That's set view to WCS. So now I'm looking straight down the z-axis. Now I want to turn on one of those operations, and sometimes I find I have to go back, turn contact points off, turn them back on again. That could just be my graphics card though. Now in the geometry view, I go to Studio Spline, which is right here, and I'm going to start drawing, and I cannot snap on those endpoints, but I can get very close though, just eyeballing it. If this spline command is kind of new to you, it's actually quite nice. It's something you might want to practice with. If I change my movement to view and I need more definition, I can just click here anywhere on the spline to create an additional intermediate point, and then I can drag that around to where it needs to be. Alright, let's click OK. And now I have a spline, but you can see you can't really see, it's buried down under the part. So it's at this point then that I need to project. So I find the project command. And I need to be careful here. I'll choose the spline, the object to project to, change it to single face and project onto your face. And right away it's kind of giving you a result because my defaults are set to Z axis from the work coordinate system, ZC, and I'm projecting both directions. I click OK, and there's a curve that I could use. Well, I mean, obviously I need to do both operations and go both sides, but that's what will be needed to create the variable axis guiding curves. Okay, now we're going to talk about the Python macro as an additional solution. And even if you have NX1899, you might like this because it creates persistent geometry that you can snap to or measure to. I'm going to be switching to NX12 to do that. I'm in NX12 now, and back at this previous version, we didn't have all the nice viewing tools that we have now, but we've got customers that would like to be able to take advantage of contact curves, so that's why I've created this Python macro to make it possible to do that in NX1102 or versions forward of that. The same situation applies with the operations, though. You need to go into the operation, non-cutting moves, the More tab, check output contact data on, click OK, and then regenerate. Okay, once that's done, you can select multiple operations that you would like contact curves for, and I've already assigned this macro to a button here. I'm going to show you how to do that yourself at the end of the video. So I just choose Create Contact Curve, and it tells me it processed two operations and created 665 lines. Okay, let's hide the two operations here, and you can see those contact curves. Now, where are they and what kind of geometry is this? If you go to the Part Navigator, it's non-timestamp geometry. Here are the 600 lines. Okay, at this point then, it's pretty straightforward to continue. I'm going to choose the Studio Spline command. And I'm just going to pick a few endpoints here. I won't create the entire curve. I think you get the idea. And if you do need to go back and add more definition, you just click somewhere back on the existing spline, and then you drag that to snap it to something else. Okay, so there's my curve. Then I could use that in the creation of the variable axis guiding, which is in fact what I did. One caveat about this, if you use the tilt tool axis, it's been my experience that the contact data gets removed. I have not checked that on all operations or all versions of NX though, just something for you to watch out for. Okay, next I'm going to show you, we're going to peek inside the Python program, and I'll show you how to get it assigned to a button on your interface. Now let's cover adding the Python macro to your NX interface. The instructions again for obtaining the macro from Maya are in the description to this video. What you'll receive are two files, the bitmap, which is the icon, and then the Python macro itself. To customize your environment, we'll right-click here in a white area. At the very bottom, look for the word Customize. Inside that interface, look for New Item on the left, and then New User Command here on the right side. Now, you could put this anywhere you want in the manufacturing environment, but I'm going to click and drag mine here on point because there are other geometry types that are being created, and so that seems intuitive to me. It's a pull down, so you're going to kind of drag here, and once it opens up, you should be able to drag and put it wherever you want to. Okay, while you have the customized environment still open, we'll right click and fill out the rest of it. Here you can change the name of the command. So there's a new name, and it's very important at the bottom to do edit action. And here we will browse for a file to use. My system comes up with VB by default. That's wrong. First, I've got to change that to Python. And here is the, I chose to put this in desktop/journal. So here's my contact curve file. Now, if you want, you can put some additional information in here. And click OK. Then I'll right click and choose Change Icon. I chose Icon Name, and now I'll browse to that same directory where the contact curve icon is. Now you can close. Let's double check. There it is. And I'll just test it one time. So I pre-select an operation, select, and it tells me it processed one operation and created 332 lines. And there they are. Now that you've got your macro assigned, you will want to come to your roles near the bottom of your resource bar and right-click and save whatever role is currently active. Otherwise, the next time you close NX and reopen it, you'd have to go back and reassign that macro. One last thing to cover today. I've brought up the Python macro here in a text editor, and I'm not going to go through a lot of the details, but I did try and put some notes in case you're curious about how this was created. Perhaps you can make some improvements to it. But there's just one thing in particular that I wanted to describe to you. Here at the bottom, there's a little macro that runs, and it just looks at the two points, the first point and the second point, before it creates the line, the little line segments you see on the screen. And if they're not at least this long, it's going to wait for a third point that might be a little farther away that meets this criteria, and then it'll make the line. And that's just to avoid a bunch of really tiny line segments that might occur, or an error situation where the two points are actually coincident and it's going to cause you a problem. So I'm in inches for this file, so 0.001 made sense. If your files are metric, you might want to change that to 0.01 or maybe something completely different. And I have had a customer use this macro on a very large operation where he created 250,000 lines. And he said it took quite a while to run. Now, in that case, I might want to actually remove this test completely. So if you're in that situation, contact me and I can help you do that, because I think it was kind of slow. And I think it's this macro that's probably slowing him down. Anyway, I hope all of this is helpful to you. Leave some comments. We'll improve upon it if we can. If you've made some improvements, let us know what they are. We'll incorporate them. Thank you.